invited here. I thank the organizer of the meeting and the participant. As you know, I'm very interested in translation of our molecular bioinformatics results into clinical care. And what motivates us in this particular study is that the head and neck cancers is one of the, I would call orphan cancer, that doesn't have much tissue at the NIH nor in any given hospitals. Even though it's very accessible, it's a very heterogeneous cancer. And for those of you that are familiar with the NCI 60 cell lines, there's not a single squamous cell carcinoma of head and neck, which is the technical term for that cancer, among the NCI 60. In other words, these tens of thousands of assays, whether it's EST, exposure to drugs with expression and so on, that has been done into these cell lines, is not available for head and neck. And if we look into the literature, the largest studies, even today, with microarray expression have merely 60 patients, which is in dire contrast with the key main cancers such as breast, prostate, lung, that have massive amount of data available for them. So we're interested in understanding the mechanism underpinning these cancers, particularly tumor suppressors at the microRNA level 3 years ago, and to develop therapies that could be network-based rather than single gene-based ones. So I'll give you the preview of take-home points. What I'd like you to retain from this presentation, then we'll go into the detail, is that we see a summative regulation of microRNA targets from which the phenotype arises. And in this case, it's an oncogenic phenotype. And I'll show you how we calculate that. And so it's really a question I would say, phenomics and scales, this study that we've done. It's how to impute from genetic traits and the gene level what are the systems property of the regulatory networks of tumor suppressor microRNAs. So one of the problems we had 3 years ago is that not only was there paucity of results, there were no microRNA assays done on head and neck cancer, and we didn't have locally enough samples to run a study that would have 60 samples. It's not a question of the money, it's a question of access to appropriately phenotyped samples. How many of you have tried to get patient tissue in the US or Canada? It's pretty difficult. France and Australia, it's easier. So it depends on the country, but I can assure you it's quite complicated. So what we did is to integrate five microRNA databases to see what were the putative targets of these microRNAs among the differential express genes in several head and neck cancer data sets between normal tissue and cancer tissue. A pretty simple question. And among, in those days, about 550 microRNAs were known. Among these 550, you could find a rationale for 500 of them. In other words, to the left here, you have the number of genes that are differentially expressed among 500 deregulated genes in the number of data sets. And there's a large number that have 60 genes among their targets and so on. Obviously, you could even make a rationale here for those that have 10 here. And we're not showing all the microRNAs' name, but all the 500 microRNAs are here. There are 10,916 microRNA gene relationships. And if you know what our fellow biologists do, they go to these web portals, they query the web portals, they try to figure out in their head what's going on manually. So we decided there was probably a better way to prioritize. And so this is kind of the summary of the overall schema of the study. We decided to develop from the expression level a test that would tell us which microRNA are probably at risk of doing this messenger RNA deregulation using the Myrnome or that aggregate of five microRNA databases. And on the other side, we decided to postulate a hypothesis, and I'll get to the detail of that later, from genetic databases, what would be tumor suppressor microRNAs, and enrich between the two what would be common and not known in the literature, and then select one according to its protein traction network and functional network from gene ontology and KEG, would be meaningful for tumor suppression of metastases. And then by choosing among a few candidates, do the experimental validation from the association study in human tissue, which is not an experimental validation yet, and then experimental validation in cell lines and mouse model, and then have a predictive model in yet untouched, though it's retrospective, study of new patients in a study from which we didn't generate any of the data. So coming back to the detail, you'll see here where the tissue comes from, so if it's a mouse or a cell or a human, because I think that helps understand where we're going. It's a hypothesis-driven bioinformatics method, so we started with the hypothesis and tried to validate up to the animal model. And so this was the hypothesis we had about tumor suppressor microRNAs. And again, since then, there's been many other authors that have published that we can, from messenger RNA expression, find microRNAs. There are probably 20 regulatory networks that can be done with both expressions, but with messenger RNA alone, there's at least 4 or 5 papers. But 3 years ago, none were published yet, and there was a polemic as to whether or not we were at the right level. As you remember, microRNAs can inhibit translation as well, and maybe it's at the protein level we should make the measurement. The keynote speaker this morning was making a big point that proteins and messenger RNA expression don't correlate well, and we were in the impression that we would have enough signal genome-wide at the messenger RNA, but I can tell you within our own institution, half the microRNA experts thought we were delirious. Fortunately, it got confirmed by many other authors, but there was this challenge at that time that perhaps it's rather translational inhibition rather than messenger RNA degradation that microRNAs do. We know better now. We know it depends on the context. The same targets could, in one cell type, be degraded at the messenger RNA from the 3' UTR alignment. And in another context, the same target could actually not be degraded by the microRNA, but be inhibited in terms of the translation. So it's kind of a complex biological problem. And the idea was simply that if we were to mine OMIM, the online Mendelian inheritance in man, and find all the cancers there, and we could triangulate through mapping it to SNOMED, which is the equivalent of gene ontology, but in medicine, there's 500,000 concepts organized as a directed acyclic graph. We could find classes of cancers, such as epithelial cancers, that would be subjected to microRNA regulation, or specific cancers, or there's even embryologic anatomy in SNOMED, so you can actually find cancers from the same embryologic tissue, such as the ectoderm or the endoderm, that would be controlled by the same microRNA. And that makes a lot of sense, because when you think of microRNAs, they are involved in embryologic development for tissue specialization, and cancer does require some de-differentiation, so that microRNAs are key regulators there made a lot of sense. So we simply did text mining of and identified 700 genes that were mapped to about 3,000 cancer terms into OMIM. And among these, we did hypergeometric calculator, like we would do with AGO enrichment, for the among the mirror genome, which microRNAs would target a number of these genes. So it takes into account the fraction. So if a microRNA targets 2,000 genes and another one targets 200, obviously finding the same 40 gene targets among epithelial cancer would be much more meaningful for the one with a smaller amount of targets. We further develop a technique to reduce the false positive rate. As you know, when you do these enrichment studies, as soon as you have a gene set that's inherited to the parent into a directed acyclic graph, if the parent has more genes, let's say twice as many genes coming there, and the child concept was very enriched, like a p-value of 10 minus 6, it's very likely that just that inheritance of those genes, even with noise coming in, will still give a significant p-value, perhaps 10 minus 6. So this is an algorithm that we developed that actually is very conservative and will truncate any inheritance of p-values that are less significant among the parents than the child, and just retain some key elements, such as the yellow ones here, and their descendant, because we believe that if the p-value is what we call a regional minimum here, and the parent has the same p-value or lower, that's not significant, but what's underneath, if it's significant, is part of the system's biology of that module, that bio module. And that has since been also published as an independent paper called Go Modules. Now, how many terms did we annotate? We did actually all of medicine. So if you look into other phenotype annotation to genes, there's the similar paper from Zach Kohani and Atul Butte, which was the Human Phenome in Nature Biotechnology some 3 years ago. And then OMIM itself is not curated, so these data sets that are, it's not curated to an ontology, but it is curated. So those that are not ontology anchored are in white here. And so there were a number of other systems. So this is just to give you an idea of the structure. We discovered about 46 predicted tumor suppressor at different layers of type of cancers, 25 of which were known in the literature as tumor suppressors. So we had significant enrichment, as you can see. I'm not showing the p-value here. And we had 21 undiscovered one. Then we triangulated with a new calculator, in which case it's a rank-based calculator using expression and microRNA targets again, that's taking genome-wide expression. We don't we just rank the expression, so we don't use any threshold in the expression level. And then discovered in head and neck cancer that there were 34 microRNAs that were imputed in common between two data sets, between cancer genes and non-cancer tissue. And again, that enrichment among our prediction was very significant. So we thought we had a good number of candidates here. And when we start triangulating the two studies together, the genetic hypothesis of tumor suppressor microRNA should over-target oncogenes. Now, how is that plausible to start with? As you know, oncogenicity is a property for genes that could arise from a single gene. If you have a mutation in the BRCA1 or BRCA2 gene that increases the function of that gene at the same level of expression, actually, the risk factor can increase 20 times for a woman to have a breast cancer in her lifetime, to such an extent that some actually have mastectomy in prevention of breast cancer in those cases. In other cases, instead of having that variant polymorphism, a normal BRCA1 gene that is repeated by copy number variant will also acquire, through expression increase rather than functional change, the same oncogenic property. So our idea was that if a number of oncogenic genes were under control of tumor suppressor microRNAs, even though microRNA probably just reduces by 30% their expression on average, it would have a systems property. This is the summative effect in genetics of having a tumor suppressor effect on these oncogenes. In other words, these genes which in normal function and at normal expression are not oncogenic would be under control. They would not just be without feedback loops regardless. And that was our hypothesis. And again, and this side here was a hypothesis-driven idea of what's a tumor suppressor, and this side is a data-driven idea of what are targets of microRNAs, and finding the same microRNA deregulating the status of normal tissue to cancer at the expression level, and controlling systems at the genetic level we thought would be a pretty strong signal. And now we then looked into the 34 gene targets of microRNA 204 that were deregulated using SAM analysis at a false discovery rate of 5%. And, before we went to microRNA 204, we looked into the literature as well. So there was an enrichment at every level between the predictions from OMIM, the predictions from expression, and the literature. So that's the enrichment here, very significant. But we looked into those that were not known in pink here in the literature. So there were 8 candidates for head and neck cancer. And we chose among these 8 candidates microRNA 204. And I'll show you a bit later why we chose the microRNA 204. There were 34 of its targets, and there were 800 targets of microRNA 204, but according to microRNA sequence-based predictions, which are about 30% accurate in general. 34 that we could find differential express across two data set. And in order to confirm these, we did a laser microdissection of human tissue and took the head and neck cancer, not the stroma, and verified the expression of these genes. As you can see, everything that's above, this is an inhibition of expression. Everything that's above the yellow red line is significant. And we had a couple that didn't work, four that didn't work here. This is an association to human tissue, showing also the GO ontology terms that were enriched in the head and neck cancer data sets without looking into the microRNA targets. And then we did a network analysis that we call SPAN, single protein analysis of network. And different from my predecessor, we, instead of doing a bootstrap, which would maintain the scale-free network identical through bootstrap, but modifying the expression value, we decided instead to do a permutation resampling to control perhaps a little more stringently for hubness. We took the differential express genes at a false discovery rate of 5%, put them into the network, and every gene in the permutation resampling would have as many neighbors, but different neighbors. In other words, the node degree was constant per gene, which was a quite complex computation. It took about 3 months just to develop how to aggregate a network in a greedy way, in a scale-free way, rather than a random way. But what it gave us is a way to analyze hubness, certainly in a conservative way. So this is actually the analysis we went downstream to do in a number of microRNAs to select the most interesting one in terms of tumor suppressor. So there was some insight of biologists here. What we did is the GO enrichment of differential express genes between normal tissue and cancer tissue, and here we're showing cell adhesion in yellow and cell cycle in blue, which we thought were important conditions for tumors, for metastases. And at a different scale, we take the differential express gene and we find which genes have more partners among the differential express one than conservatively controlled by the scale-free network that we built. In other words, a hub would have always as many companion as a hub, but since we would change the edges and it would be different genes, the question is whether they'll have as many companions that are differentially expressed. And in other words, the advantage of this network is that the p-values assign, if a gene has only one partner in the whole network of 50,000 connections, and it's very unlikely that this partner would occur using this control, you could have a better and more significant p-value with a gene with only one partner than a hub that aggregates five or six partners in the differential express gene. So it's very sensitive also to at every level. Now, what's interesting is to show that the cytoscape drawing using the organic graph shows a very neat delineation that the protein traction that was prioritized, where the large circles mean false discovery rate of 5% and the other ones are simply partners, has a good part of the cell adhesion cell cycle genes, and that they aggregate according to two networks. There were signatures that would predict response to therapy in head and neck cancer. One is called a STAT1 signature because STAT1 is considered by the biologist a key seminal gene, and you can see here it's right in the middle connecting signals between cell cycle and cell adhesion. So this was by serendipity a nice confirmation that we were onto something. Additionally, we used the Mark Gernstein's bottleneck calculator and the his stringent or his criteria of hubness and bottleneckness, which is the top 20% in the network, and we have a significant enrichment of hubness. We cannot claim we control for bottleneckness. I think the previous speaker has, through bootstrap, a better control for that, and we probably would need to do a bootstrap. But for hubness, we have 50% of the genes that are identifying this network as hub. As you can see, that this looks more like 20%, those that are not connected. By the way, in the bottom part, the genes that are not connected, it's not that they don't have protein traction. We're just showing the protein tractions that are significant according to our control rather than all the protein traction. Otherwise, you'd have a hairball. And then we started looking into cell lines that would be significant for showing that changing the activity of this microRNA would lead to changes in the in 3 minutes. Very good. Well, so here we have the targets of the gene. We have exposed the cell lines to microRNA 204 and a control mimic microRNA that is nonsensical. And you can see again the inhibition of microRNA 204 in the majority of these targets work. These are four controls to show you where the activity of controls is. And you can see it didn't work in three of them. I'm not showing the activity on the other cell line, but it's the same activity. We then did also invasion assays, and we have similarly an inhibition of invasion with microRNA expression. And then let's jump to the results. We did expose the cell lines during 4 days in vitro before a tail vein injection, and it's a long model where 3 weeks later you sacrifice all the animals and you verify the number of metastases, and we had a very significant difference in terms of metastases in the animal model. Going back to that independent data set, the microRNA 204 targets were also predictive of outcome. Not a very good p-value, but the gene signature that was published had a p-value of 5% with 250 genes. So to have a subset of 20 genes get a 9% or 10% p-value, we thought was a trend at least. And finally, and I would argue, do your genetics up front. When we start looking deeper into the genetics, we found that in the 9Q21 loci where the miR-204 is located, the Hol's gene is TRAMP3, there's 37% of head and neck cancer that have a lesion there, and there are two independent clinical studies that have verified and confirmed in traditional genetics a linkage in that area. However, there's subsequent studies that cannot find any protein coding genes in that area that would be associated with the results. In other words, maybe it's a non-protein coding gene that's associated with the tumor suppressor activity that is known in that loci for head and neck cancer. So arguably, we could have done that review of literature and select among the 8 candidates of microRNA tumor suppressors in the beginning using this genetic, but that came as additional validation when we were done. So again, I hope that you can see that we've looked into the summative effect of the targets of microRNAs to see how a phenotype arises using traditional genetics that were copy number variant changes among the targets and affecting the expression, or simply the activity, such as a mutation with a gain of function on an oncogene, we could actually infer a different genetic mechanism responsible of tumor suppressor in microRNAs. And there are many partners. We had, so a senior co-author is Rosie Sheng for the experiment. Mark Lingen is the pathologist that helped us with this. Ralph Waxenbaum with the cell lines that he meticulously froze so many samples 20 years ago that they're just a few passages since the biopsy, actually, even though they're 20 years old, and a number of other partners that came in. The key first authors here were Yonghee Lee and Shinan Yang that contributed respectively the omim and the microRNA expression calculators. Thank you for your time.